Hello, classic rock fans. Today's video is just sort of a roundup of a handful of classic rock documentaries I've watched over this past month. So I thought I would just take this opportunity to kind of run through them and tell you what I thought. And I'll tell you up front, if you're interested in any of the three I'm about to get into, I already recommend them, but stick around to find out why. The three I watched recently are Michael DeBar, Who Do You Want Me to Be?, Gordon Lightfoot, If You Could Read My Mind, and Jimmy Carter, Rock and Roll President. All three were really good in different ways, so I'm just going to give you my thoughts on each one and why I think you should check it out. So let's get started. The first one is called Michael DeBar, Who Do You Want Me to Be?
I'd like to meet a friend of mine, Mr. Michael DeBar.
Michael DeBar, Michael DeBar. Oh, Michael DeBar. He's a bit like an Arthurian character in that way, that one day they come out of the forest and the mist and they're just there and nobody knows where they really came from.
He's from show business.
He's the essential rock star.
He's a wonderful actor.
I've been using my vibe as currency since I was 8 years old.
He would disappear with Jimmy Page for days too. And I was just like, oh!
We've been through a lot. A lot of it I don't remember.
Yeah, we're the keepers of the truth. We're the children of the Renaissance.
You can learn how to sing and you can learn how to act, but learning how to be famous is a hands-on deal.
I've done Alf, for Christ's sake. I've acted with a goddamn sock and I've played Live Aid.
He's a showman.
He's a poet.
He's a philosopher.
Sometimes you think, well, who is the real Michael? And it's kind of a redundant question.
All that matters is
right here, right now, man.
And I happen to believe that's true.
So, Michael DeBar is not a household name, even for most classic rock fans. I sort of describe him as a character actor of rock and roll, meaning he's been around for a really long time and he's in a lot of stuff and he's been part of some projects, but he's never been the true star of the show. And it's sort of funny that I would describe him like that because he also has this whole other showbiz career where he is also an actual character actor in Hollywood, in movies. Again, a series of supporting roles where he's not front and center, but still a very prolific career. Lots of roles to his name. So why is this a good documentary? Well, it was directed by J. Elvis Weinstein, who's formerly of Mystery Science Theater. I believe he was the voice of Tom Servo. And if you don't believe my compliment about this rock documentary, check out what his former MST3K expatriate Frank Conniff says, TV's Frank. This is from a stream that Frank and Trace do every month called The Mads Are Back. J. Elvis popped on as a special guest. Here's Frank talking about this documentary.
It's a great documentary. People should check it out.
Yeah, where can people watch it?
There have been a lot of music documentaries lately, and I'm into that. So I watched the Bee Gees one, and I watched the Zappa one that's new. None of them, and I mean this sincerely, are as good as Josh's documentary.
So that's a heck of a big compliment right off the bat. And it's all for a guy who, again, is not really a household name. Some people might know Michael DeBar as the guy who stepped in for Robert Palmer during the Power Station tour in 1985. Well, that was just one summer. This guy has had an entire career both before and after that, so there's a lot of story to talk about. And the doc starts off on actually a pretty heavy note. So Michael DeBar never really knew his father, and his mother was a sex worker. And when he was a child, he was sent off to an English boarding school. Now, I've read a number of Mick Jagger biographies, and all of them like to giggle about how Mick Jagger also went to an English boarding school. And the story with English boarding schools in the 60s is that they were all boys' schools, and there was a lot of sexual experimentation between the students there. So all these books about Mick that I have like to giggle about how Mick was probably experimenting sexually with other boys during his time there because that was so common for that time. Now, in this doc, Michael talks about that aspect of English boarding schools, but Michael puts sort of a different spin to it. He acknowledges that, yes, there was a lot of sexual experimentation between the students there, but there was also a shitload of sexual abuse from the teachers and the staff and all the adults that were around these schools. And when he started talking about that, immediately I thought of those books that I've read, and you realize, like, this really isn't that funny. You know? It wasn't really funny to begin with. Now, he doesn't say if he was sexually abused during his time there, but he definitely says that he was around pederasts and sexual predators. And he certainly talks about how men at least attempted to abuse him. Thankfully, it doesn't get too graphic, but it is a very heavy topic to open the documentary with. But it's an important subject to talk about, because if this stuff gets left unsaid, then guys who write books about Mick Jagger and Keith Richards and any other famous English person who went to these all-boy English boarding schools in the 60s and 70s, they get to giggle about how it's one big frat house with all these boys just, you know, experimenting with each other, when in reality, there was a much darker and more serious side to it that should be discussed more. That's the actual important thing that should be discussed, not the stuff that went on between students. So, I don't want to get too deep into this because this is a wildly uncomfortable topic, but I think it was really brave for the documentary to just open with that. It grabs your attention and it makes you realize that you're in for a pretty serious story. So I appreciated that aspect to it. So right out of this boarding school, Michael just sort of stumbles into a film career. They don't say exactly how he got these roles, but like right off the bat, one of his first movies was a bit role in a movie with Sidney Poitier. I hope I didn't butcher his name just now, but you're talking about one of the greatest actors of all time sharing a screen with Michael DeBar, fresh out of boarding school. So he's just part of Hollywood, doing movies, no leading roles, again, a character actor background. In some movies, I'm sure he was just an extra, but he's making money. He's going from film to film. And as it gets into the 70s, he starts to pay more attention to the rock and roll scene, particularly Led Zeppelin. And he sees guys like Robert Plant. And he thinks, that's what I want to be. I want to be a rock and roll star. I want to be a front man of a rock band. And he pivots his career. Still staying in show business, but now he wants to do music instead of acting. So he becomes friends with Jimmy Page, starts to develop a reputation in the music scene, and gets these opportunities to be in a couple of bands and even put out his own solo records. In fact, he was on Led Zeppelin's Swan Song label. But in each of these cases, none of these projects ever punched through. He never had a hit with any of them. And that's largely because at this point of his life, he was pretty much a hardcore drug addict and seemingly a sex addict. And he talks about how the music career was more or less just the vehicle for him to indulge his appetites. It takes all the way up until 1985 for him to truly have a successful year. In 1985, a band called Animotion covered a song that he wrote called Obsession. Now, I'm sure any 80s music fan or any classic rock fan or anyone who listens to, like, variety radio knows this song. You are an obsession, you're my obsession. The story behind that song is that Michael wrote it. He wrote it back in 1983 for a film with another very successful songwriter named Holly Knight. So the song that he wrote and recorded for that film, that wasn't a hit, which was fairly typical for him. But it stayed out there, and some producer got it in front of Animotion, and Animotion had a huge worldwide hit with it. Now, around that same time, Andy and John Taylor got together with drummer Tony Thompson and vocalist Robert Palmer for a supergroup project called The Power Station. Now, if you watch my old channel, you know I've done a video about The Power Station. So they do the Power Station record. That is an actual hit. That's a smash hit, one of the biggest hits of the year. And they're about to go out on tour to promote it. And at the last minute, Robert Palmer steps out, decides he wants to go do his own record instead. And he does, and that ends up being a huge hit too. But he leaves the rest of the guys in the Power Station sort of in the lurch. And they need somebody to sing with them because they booked all these dates. I don't know if they tried anybody else, but at least partially because Michael had a track record of being a frontman in all these bands from the 70s up until 1985, and because he had written this song, which was a hit that very year, the guys thought he would be the man for the job, and he was. And he toured with the Power Station in the summer of 1985, the first gig of which being Live Aid. Yeah, one of the biggest concert events of all time. That's his introduction with the Power Station. Shortly after that, the band is featured in an episode of Miami Vice, which was the biggest TV show at the time. And they go on a very successful summer tour. After the tour, Power Station breaks up. And after that big year, 1985, he realizes, well, I'm not going to top that. And he pivots his career back to acting. And he starts picking up roles. Some fairly big roles. He's most famous for being the villain Murdoch in the TV show MacGyver. Just last year, I watched Under Siege with Steven Seagal, and Michael DeBar shows up for like a minute in that. As a henchman for the bad guys. I remember when I was watching last year, I was like Leonardo DiCaprio in that meme where he's just like, you know, watching the movie, and it's just like, hey, there's Michael DeBar. So he's had a successful second act, if you will, as a character actor in Hollywood. So he's a really interesting guy, and I think he's a great subject for a documentary. He's great on camera. He's really fun to listen to. He's very engaging when he's talking. So, like, when he's sharing his stories, that's all really good. And to the doc's credit, they get some great people to show up on camera for him. Michael was good friends with Don Johnson from Miami Vice. Don Johnson shows up. They talk about how they lived together in the 80s and how they got him on Miami Vice. One thing I should have mentioned earlier is that Michael was married to Pamela DeBar. Pamela is most famous for writing this book, I'm With the Band, Miss Pamela, the famous Miss Pamela, queen of the groupies. Michael fell in love with her, and they got married, and she shares her perspective all the way through. And seeing her on camera talk about their stories made me think there should be a documentary about Pamela DeBar. So here's my plea to the director, J. Elvis Weinstein. Make your next documentary about Pamela DeBar. I could very easily see that being a great companion piece with this one. She's got a fascinating story. It's all out there. She's written about it. I know there's definitely been some TV specials about her, but a full-on proper documentary made currently, that would be great. I guess I only have two criticisms, and neither one are probably fair. One, it would have been nice to have seen the Animotion music video, if even for a moment. Like, I think it's important to remind people what the hit actually was. And it's a funny video, so, like, you know, they should have showed that and had him talk about what he thought about that music video for a little bit. I suspect they didn't show that, probably because of a rights issue. And the other thing I would have liked to have seen is, it would have been pretty cool if they got Jimmy Page to talk about Michael. Now, that's sort of a ridiculous ask. I think being sort of a talking head in documentaries like these is probably not a priority for Jimmy Page at this point of his career. So it's not really a criticism. I guess it's just a missed opportunity, but it was probably never truly an opportunity. And finally, I gotta celebrate the ending to the doc. There's a credit sequence that features Stevie Van Zandt from the E Street Band and now Underground Garage on Sirius XM. Michael's day job nowadays is the morning DJ for Underground Garage. Underground Garage is largely a throwback channel, mostly old music. And over the credits, Stevie Van Zandt talks about how Michael is like the perfect guy to introduce these songs and these artists because he was there. And he knew these people, and he knew their stories, and he has insight to what that world was. And I think Michael started this satellite radio job after the doc was largely finished, so I think this was the only part that they could put it. But it works really well, and I won't ruin it, but the last bit of dialogue that J. Elvis has with little Steven is hilarious, and it ends the movie on a really strong note. So, Michael DeBar, Who Do You Want Me to Be? Great documentary, very good subject for a documentary. Michael DeBar is a really interesting guy, very camera-friendly, very fun to listen to, and tip of the hat to J. Elvis Weinstein for making this movie. I really enjoyed it and I really recommend it. Even if you don't know who Michael DeBar is, if you're a rock and roll fan, I think it's a good watch. So the next doc I watched was called Gordon Lightfoot, If You Could Read My Mind.
He is one of the greatest examples of timeless singer-songwriter.
If there was a Mount Rushmore in Canada, Gordon would be on it.
He's a Canadian national hero, but he also speaks with a voice for anyone.
The melodies are so powerful, and he's such a good storyteller, and the combination of those things just really makes for a great song.
I knew that I had to sit down and do the work.
I sometimes wonder, really, how I was able to do that. I'm grateful. I've been gifted.
So, I missed a chance to see this documentary at the Milwaukee Film Festival in 2019. I wanted to see it, but I didn't make it a priority because at the time, I really only knew two Gordon Lightfoot songs. I knew I wanted to get into them, but I just hadn't at that point. And that's bad on me. I am far too late to the game when it comes to Gordon Lightfoot. And I don't know why, because the two songs I knew, The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald and Sundown, are two fucking killer songs. Great fucking songs. So I don't know what my apprehension to getting into his music has been all these years, and I'm going to correct that this year. So knowing that I wanted to start listening to Gordon Lightfoot music, I decided, you know, this was a great opportunity now to just check out this doc that I had made a note of. And unlike the other two documentaries I'm talking about today, Gordon Lightfoot, If You Could Read My Mind, is available right now. Don't know for how long, but is available right now for free on Tubi. If you have a streaming device, jump on Tubi and watch that documentary. Because, like with the last one, I really recommend it. The documentary presents him as the Canadian answer to Bob Dylan. Super well-respected and also commercially successful folk rock artist out of the 60s and 70s. But beyond the music, the main takeaway for me in this documentary is that Gordon Lightfoot is just about the coolest guy who's ever lived. And I just enjoyed hearing stories about him. Everything he did was really interesting, really fun to hear about. People seem to have so much admiration for him. And even in, like, the dark part of the movie, which talks about his an alcohol addiction, they show clips of him when he was drunk on TV or at these parties, and he still comes off as really fucking cool.
How do you remain so prolific year after year?
The odd drink helps.
He had some of his famous parties full of celebrities.
Which I know I shouldn't say like that, because they do talk about some times where things got dark and, you know, he wasn't the cool guy that's presented on film. But, like, there was no point of the documentary where I looked at him and thought, oh, man, that's too bad. Like, every point they showed him, it was just like, man, this is a dude I wanna be at a party with. This is a guy whose music I want to listen to. And he quits drinking by going on long canoe trips in the Canadian wilderness, basically. He becomes an outdoorsman. And it's just like, oh, okay, so the guy gets even cooler, just like that. He pulls himself out of a drinking problem by becoming even more of a man's man, you know? Great stuff. This is a pretty positive documentary all the way through. Very interesting, and it shows how much respect that his contemporaries and also his fellow Canadians have for him. I always appreciate that Canadians show up for their own, and all kinds of Canadian rock stars show up in the doc just to talk about how much respect they have for Gord. The guys from Rush are in it. Randy Bachman is in it. The only one who was missing, and I guess this would be one of two criticisms I have for this movie, both of which, again, like with before, probably not fair criticisms, is the only one that was missing was Neil Young. I would have liked to have seen Neil Young talk a little bit about Gordon Lightfoot. Or even better, having like a 5-minute segment where Gordon and Neil talk about how they felt about each other back in the day. Or maybe just them sharing some stories of the old days coming up on the folk circuit in the 60s. You know, whatever it was where they were around each other. Because, you know, Neil's also been sort of described as the Canadian answer to Bob Dylan. And I think there's a lot of mutual respect between those two guys. And I think that could have been really awesome to see them interact for a little bit. But again, I don't know if they're like friends. And I also don't know, sort of like with Jimmy Page, I have to assume that being like a talking head in a music documentary is not a big priority for Neil. The only other criticism, I guess, I have for this is that for some reason, Alec Baldwin is one of the talking heads.
This is a guy that sang poems.
I didn't get it. Like, I don't have any problems with Alec Baldwin. I like him in some stuff. I don't really like him in other stuff. I know his wife has been getting some flack on social media lately. But I don't really have any strong opinions about Alec Baldwin. I don't know why he was in this documentary beyond the fact that he's a celebrity willing to talk about Gordon Lightfoot. And if that's the long and short of it, well, I guess I would have just cut that part out. I don't. If he's just a guy who likes Gordon Lightfoot, well, I don't care. You know, show me an artist who was influenced by him or played with him or something. That's far more interesting to me than just a famous person talking about their fandom. So I guess that would have been the only thing that kind of took me out of it, was just like, why the hell is Alec here? I don't get it. Didn't really need to hear his take, but ultimately not a real big complaint. Okay, and then the third documentary I watched recently is Jimmy Carter, Rock and Roll President.
One of the things that have held America together has been the music that we share and love.
Jimmy Carter used music in a way that helped him in his politics, but it had never been done quite that way.
I'd like to dedicate this song to Jimmy Carter.
I want to introduce to you the great Allman Brothers.
Find the old man, I don't know.
He was
cool, he enjoyed our music, and he became a friend.
When I first met Jimmy, first thing he did was quote my songs back to me.
We now had a president that started to see the world the way we saw it.
His love for music makes sense to me because music is the voice of the heart.
One of the reasons that musicians were drawn to President Carter, he was a man of the earth. For God's sake, he was a peanut farmer.
That was the music of change and dissidence. There was a risk politically for that, and it didn't matter to him.
I think music is the best proof that people have one thing in common, no matter where they live, no matter what language they speak.
Now, this documentary is a little different than the other two. The other two were basically biographies of Michael DeBar and Gordon Lightfoot. This is not really a biography, per se, of Jimmy Carter. I would describe it as a collection of anecdotes, stories, and friendships that involve former president Jimmy Carter and various high-profile musicians, particularly rock stars. For instance, Jimmy is close personal friends with Willie Nelson and Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan has been one of my best friends, along with Willie Nelson.
And they tackle this right off the bat. One of the first scenes is President Carter playing a Bob Dylan record and talking about how he's good friends with Bob. And then cuts to Bob, who actually shows up to be sort of a talking head in this documentary, which is, I guess, maybe why I was thinking of who would have been, it would have been nice to see in the other two. And don't forget, you know, Jimmy Page and Neil Young might be above showing up in these sort of documentaries. I would assume Bob Dylan would be too, but I guess when it comes to an ex-president, well, you show up if he calls. But that's incredible, because I don't think Bob Dylan typically does this sort of thing, and I think that should put this doc sort of on the radar for any Bob Dylan fans. And it was very cool to see Bob Dylan talk very positively about Jimmy. And then also early in the film, and I believe this is used in the trailer as well, Jimmy tells the story about Willie Nelson coming to the White House for a visit, staying overnight, and at some point going up on the roof of the White House and smoking some weed.
When Willie Nelson wrote his autobiography, he confessed that he smoked pot in the White House. And he says that his companion was one of the servants at the White House. Actually, was one of my sons.
And he tells this story with all of the enthusiasm of, like, the father of a football player telling people about how his son won the Super Bowl. You know? Just incredibly proud of this little anecdote, which is very funny, very charming. And from there, the early parts of the documentary discuss how music was one of the main things that Jimmy was able to bond with his children over. And I think that speaks to a lot of parent-child relationships, is the love of the same music, and it's a real heartwarming note to sort of open the movie on. And the documentary just goes from story to story of Jimmy having these music icons over to the White House, not just rock and roll, but country musicians, jazz musicians, folk singers, gospel singers, all kinds of artists. He was just a guy who loved music, and he wanted that to be part of his political career. There is a truly bizarre moment closer to the end of the film where he's on the campaign trail for re-election in 1980. And he's brought on stage by, of all people, Charlie Daniels, who supported him in that run and was good friends with him. And I'm reading Charlie's book right now, and I paged around to try and find his account of that event, and I couldn't find anything. He does mention that he was friends with Jimmy Carter, but he does not make any mention of campaigning with him, at least unless I missed something. And I think the only missed opportunity of this documentary was to get Charlie Daniels on camera for a bit to talk about his relationship with Jimmy Carter, because Jimmy mentions him a couple of times, and Charlie is this famous Republican in the music industry, and it could have been a cool moment to see these two guys on different ends of the political spectrum, you know, share some mutual admiration or respect. But, you know, Charlie died last year. I have to assume this doc was made before he passed away. I don't know if anyone reached out to him. I have to wonder if they did ask him if he would have even agreed to sit down for it, because, you know, a major part of Charlie's brand in the back half of his career is being an incredibly outspoken proponent of all of the politics that Jimmy Carter stood against. So maybe it would not have been good for Charlie's brand to be seen on camera talking, presumably positively, about a political figure that a lot of Charlie's constituency wouldn't get behind. So I really enjoyed this documentary because it's not just a celebration of the music I love, and really music itself, but it reminds us who Jimmy Carter was as a man beyond just his political record. Obviously, the main thrust of the documentary is that he was a music fan, and that should be celebrated. And he used his platform to bring in great musical acts to perform at the White House. And listening to him tell these stories and going through all these events, it's a really nice reminder that Jimmy Carter is probably the most decent man to ever serve as president. I think his character stood above and beyond anyone else who's had that job. And I think what he's done in his years since being president, and they talk about this in the documentary too, his work with the Carter Foundation and Habitat for Humanity, I think he's done somehow even more good post-presidency than he ever did in office. And that's so important when you're talking about a guy's legacy. And anytime you talk about a president's legacy, I don't think that's something that can be contained in one film. I'm really happy that the people that made this documentary took this big chunk of his legacy, which is his relationship to music, and presented it all sort of all together in one piece for fellow music fans to watch and appreciate. So, of the three, I absolutely recommend this one the most. The only thing that struck me as a little odd is that for all the clips they have of Greg Allman and the Allman brothers performing at the White House and the obvious friendship Jimmy had with Greg, there's a famous Saturday Night Live sketch from the 70s that absolutely references this, and I'm surprised it didn't get a moment in the doc. So, you know, if you're an SNL fan, see if you remember this.
Ask President Carter.
Do you have a question for the president?
I took some acid. I'm afraid to leave my apartment, and I can't wear any clothes. And the ceiling is dripping, and,
Well, thank you very much for calling, sir. Please.
No, just a minute, Walter. This guy's in trouble. I think I better try to talk him down. Peter?
Yeah.
Just remember, you're a living organism on this planet, and you're very safe. You've just taken a heavy drug. Now, just relax, stay inside, and listen to some music, okay? Yeah. Do you have any Allman Brothers?
That was the first thing that came to mind. It's a great sketch. It speaks to who he is, and I was surprised that it didn't get a mention. But just my own little observation there. So, yeah, of all three documentaries, I recommend this the most, but I really do recommend all three. If you're a rock and roll fan, classic rock fan, these are all really good watches. You're going to find some stuff in there that you really enjoy, and you're absolutely going to learn some stuff in all three as well. If you're looking for some suggestions on rock docs to check out, any one of these three can't go wrong. They're all really enjoyable. So hopefully I'll get a chance to do another vlog like this soon. There's definitely some other rock docs that I want to see, particularly David Crosby, Remember My Name. I almost watched that for this. I couldn't find what service it was on, so I'll see if I can get a hold of that. And then there was one that was made, I think, 2 years ago called I Want My MTV. I actually did see that at the Milwaukee Film Festival, but I would like to rewatch that and share my thoughts. These are both fairly recent documentaries that are definitely worth exploring. So I'll try and catch those and post my thoughts as well when I can get to them. Otherwise, if you have any suggestions for me, post them in the comments below. If you've been watching any rock documentaries that you enjoyed, even if they're old ones, whatever, maybe I haven't seen it, post your recommendations and your thoughts about them in the comments. If you've seen any of the three I've discussed, please post those in the comments. And then, also, while you're at it, please subscribe to this YouTube channel. Check out our social media, at PlayThatPodcast on Twitter, Facebook.com/PlayThatPodcast, and of course, listen to the podcast, Play That Rock and Roll, on any and all of the major podcast platforms. Okay, thanks for tuning in. I think I'll play you out with the rest of that sketch from SNL. Take care.
Relax, stay inside and listen to some music, okay? Yeah. Do you have any Allman Brothers?
Yeah, I do, sir. Everything's okay, huh, Jimmy?
It sure is, Peter. You know I'm against drug use myself, but I'm not going to lay that on you right now. Just mellow out the best you can, okay?
Okay.
Okay. Well done, Mr. President.